I think we'll hear how this applies more in Northern California, right in our own backyard, from Dr. Elizabeth Rose Maeda. She is currently a postdoctoral fellow at UCSF. She earned her master's in public health in epidemiology from Columbia and her PhD in epidemiology and translational research from UCSF. Her research focuses on understanding the origins and life course mechanisms of racial, ethnic, and other social inequalities in dementia and stroke. And she is currently supported by a Pathway to Independence Award from the National Institute on Aging. Oh, Dr. Maeda.
Thank you. Thank you. Just wait for my slides to come up. Great. So today I'll be following up on Dr. Yeo's talk about racial and ethnic inequalities and dementia incidents across the United States with a study done right here in the Bay Area. So to start off, reducing racial and ethnic disparities in dementia has been identified as a national priority by the National Alzheimer's Plan. And this is really critical because it means that the government has recognized that it's really important for us to study racial and ethnic disparities in dementia and identify strategies to prevent them. But it's really difficult to understand how to prevent disparities if we don't understand the extent to which they exist. And as Glenn just pointed out, no prior studies of dementia incidents have been conducted in samples that represent the diversity of the United States, which means prior to the study I'm going to present today, we've had to try to piece together evidence across studies, and as you just saw, that's really difficult. Because most of these studies just include one or two racial and ethnic groups, and dementia rates across studies are very sensitive to the diagnostic criteria, making it really difficult, as Gwen highlighted, to try to compare across the different studies. And additionally, geographic patterns can contribute to differences across studies. So for example, the two studies of Latinos in the United States with dementia incidents are the SALSA study and the YCAP study in Northern Manhattan. So as Gwen pointed out, the SALSA study is Mexican Americans right here in California, and the YCAP study, the main Latino group represented are Dominican Latinos from the Caribbean in Northern Manhattan. And so trying to piece together what dementia incidence looks like in Latinos in the United States can't really be done by trying to combine these two studies. So today, I'll be focusing on first examining to what extent there are racial and ethnic inequalities in dementia incidence, and second, following up by looking at how long people live after a dementia diagnosis. So this study was conducted in Kaiser Permanente, Northern California, so right here in the Bay Area. And as you all probably know, Kaiser is an integrated healthcare delivery system. And there are several things that make Kaiser Permanente a really rich resource for conducting this research. The first is that the Kaiser membership is very large. So that means that even racial and ethnic groups that are represented in a relatively small proportion of the sample are still represented in large enough numbers for us to study. Second, the members of Kaiser are generally representative of the overall population of a very diverse region, with the exception that people at the extreme tails of the income distribution do tend to be underrepresented. And next, also, the Kaiser membership is very long-term. So the large, diverse Kaiser membership, people tend to remain members for a long period of time. And finally, Kaiser introduced electronic medical records way back in 1996, which means we have really long-term health information on this really large and diverse cohort of people. So the measures for our study include self-reported race and ethnicity from member health surveys, dementia diagnosis from medical records, including diagnoses of Alzheimer's disease, vascular dementia, and non-specific dementia diagnoses. Because our outcome measure was dementia diagnosis in a medical record, it means that in order for someone to receive a diagnosis of dementia, they have to actually be in contact with the healthcare system. So we have a measure that we call healthcare utilization, where we measure the proportion of people that had at least one healthcare visit per year during this baseline initial follow-up period that we had, since it's really important to understand if people are not being diagnosed just because they're not being seen by the healthcare provider, or understanding if people are being seen enough that we can feel like we're getting a reliable estimate of dementia incidence. And finally, we also have death records from fairly comprehensive sources, both from the medical records and government records. So the way that we created our study sample is that we started with the dawn of the electronic medical record system in 1996. And because we wanted to make sure that we were picking up on incident cases of dementia, not just the first one that happened to be measured in the new electronic medical record system, we implemented a 4-year washout period. And then our study sample is based on the Kaiser members who were still members without a dementia diagnosis at the beginning of 2000. And we followed this cohort of about 280,000 people for dementia diagnosis all the way through the end of 2013 for up to 14 years of follow-up. So I'll first be presenting the results on racial and ethnic inequalities in dementia incidents. So here's a brief summary of the characteristics of our sample. And there are two things I want to highlight here outlined in the red boxes. The first is that because the sample size is quite large, even racial and ethnic groups that represent a relatively small proportion of the sample are represented in fairly large numbers. And second is our measure of healthcare utilization. So as you remember, I mentioned before that because our outcome was dementia diagnosis in a medical record, people have to be in contact with the healthcare system to get diagnosed. And we'll see here that healthcare utilization was pretty high. So our measure was the proportion of people in each racial and ethnic group that had at least one healthcare visit per year for each of the 4 years of our washout period, which I think is a pretty high bar for medical utilization. You'll see that across racial and ethnic groups, the vast majority of people met this really high bar. So people were in contact with the medical system pretty regularly and therefore probably had a chance of getting diagnosed if they did have dementia. So here are our results for age-standardized dementia incidence rates by race and ethnicity. The first bar, the red bar here, shows the dementia incidence rates for African Americans. And consistent with the meta-analyses that you just saw before, dementia incidence rates do tend to be elevated among African Americans compared with other racial ethnic groups. Next, the dementia incidence rates were next highest among American Indians and Alaska Natives. And to our knowledge, this is the first study to estimate dementia incidence in this racial and ethnic group. Dementia rates were then intermediate among Latinos, and because this is in California, the main Latino group represented are Mexican Americans, and similar among Pacific Islanders and non-Latino whites. And so the similar dementia incidence rates in Latinos as in non-Latino whites in this sample is pretty consistent with the results from the SALSA study that we talked about previously, so the only other study of dementia incidence in Mexican Americans. And for Pacific Islanders, this is the first study that we're aware of to include Pacific Islanders. You'll see those large bars there, so that's the 95% confidence interval. So that group was a little bit smaller than the others, so the estimate isn't as precise, but because there were no prior studies on this racial or ethnic group, we thought it was really important to include them. And finally, dementia incidence rates were lowest among the Asian American subgroup, and that's consistent with the estimates from the Japanese American cohort studies that you just saw presented previously. And I don't have the results broken down by Asian American subgroup, but we do have a follow-up study where we have looked at Asian American subgroups. And the three Asian American subgroups that were represented in large enough numbers for us to estimate were Chinese Americans, Filipino Americans, and Japanese Americans. And we did see some variability with slightly higher dementia incidence rates in Filipinos than Chinese Americans and Japanese Americans. But overall, dementia incidence rates in each of these Asian American groups were lower than in the other racial and ethnic groups. So the next result here, so moving back to talking still now about all six of the racial and ethnic groups, I'm showing you the cumulative 25 dementia risk by race and ethnicity starting at age 65. So these estimates here are estimates of among people who survive without dementia to age 65, what proportion will we expect to develop dementia over the next 25 years? And so you'll see here that although we see variation across the racial and ethnic groups, dementia rates are very high in every racial and ethnic group. So we would estimate that more than 1 in 4 adults in every racial and ethnic group at age 65 would go on to develop dementia in their lifetime. So to summarize, we saw really marked racial and ethnic inequalities in dementia incidence with 70% higher dementia incidence rates among the highest group, which were African Americans, than Asian Americans, which were the lowest risk group in our cohort. And we saw that lifetime risk was high in all racial and ethnic groups. So this was the first study to directly compare dementia incidence in a sample representing the diversity of the United States. And as we just learned previously, previous to this study, we really had to piece together evidence across different studies. So this was the first study where we could look at all of these racial and ethnic groups in one study with the same procedures. And our findings actually substantiate and extend the findings from previous studies. So the results from our study are fairly consistent with the results that you just saw previously from the meta-analysis. In terms of thinking about what causes dementia, we still don't have a complete picture of what really influences dementia risk, but if social and behavioral factors are the primary pathways that lead to dementia and racial and ethnic disparities in dementia, that would suggest that substantial reductions in dementia incidence are possible. So not only in terms of reducing disparities in dementia incidence, but also preventing dementia in all racial and ethnic groups. Given that the lifetime risk is high in all racial and ethnic groups, this highlights that dementia research is a high priority. But one caveat is that our outcome was dementia incidence based on medical records. So what if the differences that we're picking up on are just due to differences in diagnosis, but not actual differences in dementia? Which was the motivation for why I first started thinking about looking at how long people live with dementia, which of course is also really important information for patients, their doctors, and their families. So this diagram here illustrates how timing of dementia diagnosis could contribute to estimated differences in dementia incidence, even if there really were truly no differences in dementia incidence. So if we just estimated that African Americans have higher dementia incidence because they were diagnosed earlier, and Asian Americans we just estimated that they had lower dementia incidence because they were diagnosed later, we would then think that we would estimate that also African Americans survive longer after dementia diagnosis, and Asian Americans survive shorter after dementia diagnosis. So this is part of our motivation for thinking about first looking at, for trying to look at survival after dementia diagnosis to better understand our previous findings on dementia incidence. And so here are our estimates of median survival time in years from time of dementia diagnosis to death. And you'll see that our results were not consistent with just later diagnosis in Asian Americans, because Asian Americans actually had the longest average survival time after diagnosis with about 4.5 years. From time of dementia diagnosis to death. And dementia survival time was actually shortest among non-Latino whites, with about 3 years average survival time after dementia diagnosis. So the previous slide showed estimates across all age groups, and as you would guess, that age is really an important factor in terms of estimating survival time from time of dementia diagnosis. So this diagram here shows estimates of survival diagnosis by race and ethnicity and also by age. And you'll see that we saw these fairly consistent patterns in terms of shorter survival time in whites and longer survival time in Asian Americans. But as you would also see that, not surprisingly, survival time decreases with age at diagnosis. And so one of the questions we had is, what is the most likely explanation for these racial and ethnic differences in survival after dementia diagnosis? And I won't go into the details, I'm running short on time. But what we really saw was that these racial and ethnic mortality patterns after dementia diagnosis more or less represented racial and ethnic mortality patterns in older adults regardless of dementia diagnosis, which suggests that the same factors driving racial and ethnic mortality differences in people with dementia are probably the factors that are driving racial and ethnic mortality differences among older adults without dementia. So to summarize, we found that most people live for years after dementia diagnosis with substantial differences in post-diagnosis survival by race and ethnicity, with shortest survival time in whites and longest in Asian Americans. And that these racial and ethnic mortality patterns among people with dementia were similar to patterns among people without dementia. And this suggests that timing is not the major driver of racial of the estimated racial and ethnic inequalities in dementia, and really highlights the importance and need for caregiver support for people with dementia. So to summarize the presentation, we saw marked racial and ethnic inequalities in dementia incidence that are unlikely to be solely attributable to differences in diagnosis. So the next questions are really thinking about what are the mechanisms driving these inequalities? Because in order to understand how to prevent disparities in dementia, we have to understand the major mechanisms driving them. So evidence from other studies suggests, as Dr. Yao presented, that inequalities in quantity and quality of schooling is likely a major contributing factor, and also vascular risk factors could also be a contributing factor. In terms of looking at our evidence on how long people live with dementia, we saw that most people live for years after dementia diagnosis, and again, that these patterns were more or less reflected in the older adult population. And so this here, I included in your handout, which is the Alzheimer's Association summary of current evidence on modifiable risk factors for dementia. And so the reason, and so as I highlighted before, years of formal education and vascular risk factors are possible drivers of the disparities in dementia that we observed, and they're also really they've also been highlighted by the Alzheimer's Association as possible important modifiable risk factors for dementia. And I'd like to acknowledge my co-authors and my funding sources. Thank you. Mm-hmm.